For the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Song shall rise to Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, all thy works shall praise thy name in earth and skies and sea. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. And he that have no money, come ye buy and eat. Yea, come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore do you spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfies not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye there that which is good, and let your soul delight yourself in fatness. Let us pray. Kind Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus, for giving us this invitation that we can dine with you this Sabbath day. We pray, Lord, at this time that you will hydrate our thirsty souls. And Lord, satisfy the desire of our heart, which is our relationship with you. I thank you for hearing my simple prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning and a pleasant Sabbath to you all. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Once again, it's a joy and a privilege to be in the house of the Lord. And we thank God that he's been taking good care of us every single day of our life. The scripture says that the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Hallelujah. God has been taking good care of us. And today, he's brought us all here safely. And so, I would like to welcome you in a special way to today's service. Those of us who are worshiping with us for the very first time, we say welcome. If you're a regular visitor, a big welcome to you as well. And to our members as well, we welcome you to today's service. I believe that the Lord will bless you as you worship with us today. This morning, I'd like to quickly introduce those who will be taking part in today's service. My name is Kwame Basua. I'm doing the introduction. We would have Elder Christine Jones, who will be doing our scripture reading and also did the call to worship for us. We have Brother Elder Dean, who will be doing the pastoral prayer for us. And then Brother Colin, Samuel would do the tithes and offerings for us this morning. We also have the AV team here supporting us. We've got Sister Beryl leading the songs and and playing the organ for us. We also have the praise team here to help us with our singing. And so, once again, a very special welcome to you, and I pray that the Lord will bless you. Amen.
Hope you had a blessed week and you are ready to go by the grace of God. Amen. I'm sure it's not as bleaky inside or as rainy as it is outside. Amen. Amen. God has been good. It was a blessed week for all of us. The very fact that we are here alive and well, we have to be thankful to God. Amen. So we give God thanks for his goodness and for his mercies. We'd like to welcome you wherever you are viewing from across the world. We'd like to welcome you if you are watching from the U.S., from Canada, from the Philippines, South Africa, Jamaica, the Caribbean, Europe. Wherever you are watching from, Gillingham, wherever you are watching from, we'd like to welcome you in a very special way to our live stream service today. May God bless and keep you richly as we worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Amen. And we do not take for granted that people have to wake up very early some parts of the world just to watch the program and be blessed by it. People say to me they wake up from 6 o'clock, some from 5 o'clock in the morning just to watch the program, and they are blessed by it. So whatever you are doing, keep on doing Peckham Church. Amen. Amen. We have our baptism coming up. The baptismal pool is ready to go. The candidates are getting ready. Amen. I didn't want to get the amens on my way home for the baptismal candidates, because some of them are here listening to you. And if they didn't get that amen, who knows what will happen. And some of them are here and they haven't even told us about their rebaptism as yet, but they will be telling us soon. Amen. Amen for that. So it will be the 26th of June by the grace of God, and it will be 10:30 a.m. 10:30 a.m. We are starting early so we can finish on time. We are not sure how many candidates we are going to have as yet. We leave that in the hands of the Lord. We'll have one baptism per quarter. The next one will be September, and after that our final one will be the 18th of December. So 18th of September and 18th of December will be our two final baptismal services for the year. The candidates, we are not sure what's going to happen as yet, if I'm really honest with you. The Indian variant, it was on the news that it's over here and it's spreading, so we just have to keep praying. But if the lockdown is lifted, as the roadmap suggests, if the lockdown is lifted, then we could, and mark that word, could have full service again. Amen? So we could have full service, because the 21st is when Mr. Johnson said, all things being equal, then we should be able to come back to church in our fullness by the grace of God. And things would be open up generally if things are okay. So for that baptism, who knows, it might be a big, very, very big baptism. Welcome all of you who are here locally, who have come to join us. And Sister Anderland family is just over on my left. You are giving a wave right at the PA box where it's warm and cozy. It's Sister Andel's husband that I told you, Brother Andel, sadly passed away earlier this year. And I went back to West Croydon to lay him to rest, to do the service for them. So condolences again. But good to know that you didn't come alone. You have one daughter on the left and one on the right. And I'm not saying anything. I just said one daughter on the left and one on the right. I was hoping for some amen from at least the amen corner. Let me repeat it again. Or maybe it's the daughter on the left and right you're not sure of. We have one daughter. All right. We have the Andel family visiting with us. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. And we have quite a few of you who are visiting. Elder Kwame's wife is the first I'm seeing you here since I'm here as well. And the little baby, which turns one yesterday, the little bundle of joy turns one yesterday. So happy belated birthday. And to all those who have celebrated their birthday this week or this month, may God continue to bless and keep you richly. I will not ask a show of hand as I didn't last week for those of you who remembered your first birthday, because I'm sure none of us remembered our first birthday. So your little bundle of joy, he will not be different from us. He will not remember, but we still have to mark it. Amen. We have our campaign coming up. The 4th to the 18th of September will be our grand campaign. It will be a big campaign by the grace of God. God promises to be here, and all of Peckham will be here by the grace of God. Amen. And we'll have a grand time by the grace of God. Condolences to all who are bereaved at this time. May God continue to bless and keep you, and may God give you the strength that we need. We had a funeral service this week as well on Wednesday. Bible class at 4 p.m. So Bible class 4 p.m. General Church Bible class 4 p.m. today. And at 5 p.m. we will be having our Bible class for our new members. Witnessing tomorrow, evangelism tomorrow. Can you believe that? I know that you are excited about our evangelism project. Amen. Amen. I'm excited as well. I will be here tomorrow, God willing. Rain, sunshine, snow, whatever the weather is, by God's grace, I shall be here at 10 o'clock to go out in the community. And if it's one person out here with me, then we will go out by the grace of God. If it's two, if it's 20, if it's the entire church, we'll go out in the community. Amen. And tell people about the love of God that constraineth us. And then the cooking program continues tomorrow. So cooking program continues. Tomorrow we cook lunches and we give the lunch to our folks in the community, which they are very, very appreciative of it. Just one of our neighbors that lives just beside the church here. When I was at the funeral, I met her. And Wednesday at the funeral service, she was just on the outside and spoke to her. And afterwards, you know what she said to me? She said she has been here as long as the church is here. She has been living here for a long time. And she said she really feels that the church is doing something tangible in the community. However, she said we take away her Sunday cooking from her. So imagine, she's not able to cook on a Sunday again. She's enjoying the lunch so much. And she said it wasn't even just a one-off. You didn't just do it one time and stop. You keep doing it. So she said she really, really, she's pleased with what the church is doing. Amen? So whatever you are doing, keep it up by the grace of whatever we are doing. Amen? Because sometimes on a Sunday I go in the kitchen, not to do too much, but even to pass through. No amen for me passing through the kitchen. Maybe to get some food or something. So the sick, we continue to pray for those who are unwell. Brother Kevin, I spoke to Brother Kevin this week, and he's fully out of hospital now, fully out of rehab. He's so thankful to you as a church. Amen. Amen. He's thankful. He said I should express his thanks to you as a church. And ask you to keep praying for him, because he is not fully out of the woods, but he's doing so much better by the grace of God. So let us keep praying for him. Sister Deborah, we saw Sister Deborah this week as well. She was in good spirit. Keep praying for her. And keep praying for those who are unwell. We have Brother Paco, who is still unwell. We have Sister Dawes, who is still unwell. Let us keep praying for them and so many others. But you know the name, so keep praying for those who are unwell. We have looked at those who celebrated their birthday. I've got a friend who will be Della, who will be the aunties here, Sister Yvette, somewhere around. Your niece will be celebrating her birthday tomorrow. And we are the same age, except I'm 1 month and 1 day older than her. So we will both be... Amen, amen. You get that. And also, St. Vincent Appeal, please remember, the welfare department, St. Vincent Appeal is still on. The Adra department is collecting funds. So we are asking you, please give towards the disaster in St. Vincent. The 29th of this month would be the deadline. So bring your money in, give it in the offering basket when it goes out there, but write on it, St. Vincent Appeal, and it will go towards a worthy cause. You know, the volcano is over there threatening the folks, and people are out of their homes and different things. So please give towards that cause. The deadline when we will be sending in our money from Peckham Church will be on the 29th of this month. So try and support before that time as much as possible, please. And this now is annual leave. Since I have been here, I haven't been on any annual leave. Can you believe that? No amens for that one. So I think I'm going to quietly take some annual leave. Last year at West Croydon, I didn't even take one day of annual leave. Some of it I missed, but it doesn't matter to me. But I'll be taking some annual leave. The head elder is now preaching at All Nations, so pray for her as well. She's down there preaching, so if you see half of the church missing, maybe they are down there supporting her. Who knows? But she will carry on. She will just lay hold of the mantle, and she will carry on until I get back by the grace of God. PM Day and Possibilities Day is coming up 29th of this month and 5th of June, respectively. Tomorrow, Possibilities Ministry. Tomorrow, they are having a special program at 3 p.m. Please try and join them. The departmental leader will give you more information about that. Please remember to wear your mask correctly. Wear it properly, please. We have just a short time to go, but let us please support the program. So if you are in church, wear your mask the correct way for us, please. Is that okay? Amen. Amen. And finally, we are coming down to camp meeting. We are coming down to the end. So camp meeting is coming up on the 31st of this month until the 5th of June will be our virtual camp meeting. So you won't be able to go. It's a virtual camp meeting. But do support the program by the grace of God. You'll get more information as well. And please remember to pray for Sister Ola. She asked me to ask the church to pray for her in a very special way. God bless and keep you as you continue to be blessed for the rest of the program. We'll now have our able praise team come and take us away by the grace of God. Amen.
Come into his presence with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise and be thankful unto him. We're not in his presence until we're praising and giving thanks. So if you want to be in his presence, we're going to thank him.
Thank you.
serve a risen Savior. He's not dead. That's why we are alive this morning.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in this world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always there. He lives, He lives.
Song.
ones in this world who are craving the precious earthly things afford, but none can match the priceless treasures that I find in Jesus Christ my Lord.
Church, it's time for prayer, so for those who can kneel, please kneel as we spend a few minutes talk to our Savior. Right, let us pray. Most Holy Father, we, your humble children, come here once more to lift you up. You're a good God, dear Father. You have made us out of clay. You knelt over us, and you breathed in us your living breath to make us a living soul. And we just want to thank you. We thank you, dear Father, that you have brought us through another week and has brought us upon your holy Sabbath day to just to worship you. We have done so many things in our life that is bad, dear Father. But because you love us so much, you have forgiven us for our sins. Now that we are here this morning, dear Father, to lift you up, we ask you, dear Father, to come by here with us this morning and tabernacle with us as we worship you. In a few minutes, dear Father, our pastor will break the bread of life. We ask you, dear Jesus, that you may touch his lips. Help, dear Father, that what comes out, that it may be a blessing for us and it may change us for the better. We pray for those who are sick, dear Father, at this time. Because of sin, dear Father, all of us are sick. But, dear Father, there is going to be a time when there will be no more sickness, no more pain, no more headache, no more stress, no more nothing, dear Father, for there will be peace and peace at last. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. Oh, dear Father, we'll be rejoicing. It will be a joy by and by. So, dear Father, we ask you now to forgive us our sins and help us, dear Father, that we may be obedient children for you. Bless us and guide us now. And I just want to lift up Sister Ola, who's going into operation. I don't know if it's next week or when. But you may be with the doctors, dear Father, that we will be carrying out this operation. Be there at her side. Bless those, dear Father, that who are feeling sick at this time. Help, dear Father, that you may be with them and you may comfort them in their sickness. We pray, dear Father, for those who have healed, dear Father, like Kevin, who is rejoicing in you at this time. We pray and we thank you for that, dear Father. There are many more that you have showed that you are still in the healing process. We just want to thank you. Bless us now, I pray, as we worship you today, that we may worship you in the beauty of holiness. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Church. It's now time for our tithe to return our tithes and offering, but because of our current situation, the deacon and deaconess won't be coming around at this time. At the end of the service, we'll be operating a one-way system out. You'll go through to my right to go out. The deacon and deaconess will be at the door to collect your offering at that time. Also, for those who choose to return their offering by online, the bank account details will be shown on screen, where you can send. Yeah, it's on the screen now. You can pay your offering and return your tithes and offering online. Send us an email or a text message to let us know the breakdown so we can allocate the funds correctly. Just a reminder that the tithes that you return goes to the conference to pay for the administration and pay for the pastors and such like. The offering which you return stay in the local church to help spread the gospel locally. So tithes is for go to the conference to spread the gospel. The offering stay in the local church to spread the gospel locally. Starving for many days, Pavel prayed, "Dear Lord, please forgive me for using your tithes in a time of need. But if you help me to repay it, I promise I'll never use it again to benefit myself, even if I die." Living as a married student in the communist Romania, and without an income, Pavel decided sometime before to resort to using $40 tithes he had set apart in order to purchase food for his family. He and Dina, his wife, were starving as the can he was collecting and selling were barely able to provide for his little son milk. He took the money, planning to return what he borrowed from the Lord as soon as possible, expecting that God would understand. But then his father died, and things grew even worse because the stipend he had been receiving from his father stopped coming. arriving at home from university that day, Pavel found a letter containing $50. He resisted the temptation to help himself to the money. Instead, he immediately mailed to the church treasurer the $40 he owed to God, plus the $5 that is due as tithes from this new gift. With the remaining five, he and Dina were able to buy only some bread and yogurt. How are you doing, Pavel? A 92-year-old man who was a fellow church member asked him a few days later. You don't look okay. What's happening? Why don't you take the bus instead of walking? Pavel was unable to escape all the questioning. Then the man said, well, I am a retired lawyer and have some funds. I was praying to God, asking who I could help. Now I found him. From now on, until you finish your university education, I will send you $500 every month to take care of your needs. And then he added, but don't forget to share to others when you are blessed. Pavel is now the editor of the ministry magazine and work at the General Conference office in Silver Spring, Maryland, USA. Appeal to you today is, let us take advantage of every crisis to strengthen our trust in the Lord, learning about his mighty power to save. Let us pray. Father, we give thee thanks for the opportunity which we have to learn more about you, to trust you, and to return to you our tithes and our offering. Bless it now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Everyone, it's Aunt Fernita. Today's story is called Loving the Unlovable. The memory verse for today's story is 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 17. It says, show proper respect to everyone. Love the brotherhood of believers. Today's message is God wants me to include those who get left out. When Raphael and his family moved to a new neighborhood, he felt lost. He felt lonely at his new school. Then one day, a student came up to him in the hall and said, hi, I'm Corinne. I've seen you, but I don't know you yet. Come sit with me and my friends during lunch. Someone else included people who were left out. Jesus. He was friends with everyone. The dinner party at Simon's house was the place to be. Simon was one of the leading Jewish rulers, and Jesus had healed his leprosy. To show his thanks, Simon planned a huge feast for Jesus. Everybody who was anybody came. Mary was there too. She was the kind of person people talked about, not to. Everyone knew she was a sinner. Everyone knew Jesus had ordered 7 unclean spirits out of her. She probably wasn't even invited to the party. But since she followed Jesus everywhere, no one stopped her. They just wanted her to stay quietly in the background. Mary knew about her reputation. She knew she was not accepted in polite company, but she wanted to show Jesus how thankful she was. She had with her a small alabaster jar of perfumed ointment. When no one was looking, she poured the ointment over Jesus' head and feet. Her tears of love and thanks flowed into the ointment. Quietly, she knelt down and wiped Jesus' feet with her long, flowing hair. Probably no one would have noticed if it weren't for the fragrance. It smelled so good and quickly filled the whole room. People started talking. "That stuff is expensive," they whispered to each other. "It cost what a man earns in a whole year. If she sold it, the money could have been given to the poor. What a waste." Simon had a different thought. If Jesus really were a prophet, he wouldn't let that woman touch him. She's a terrible sinner. Mary was caught, and she was embarrassed. Jesus knew what Simon was thinking. He also knew what Mary was feeling. "Leave her alone," he told the whisperers. "You will always have the poor with you, but you won't always have me. She has done a beautiful thing for me." Then Jesus turned to Simon. "Two men owed money to the same money lender," he said. "One man owed 500 denarii. The other owed 50 denarii. The money lender knew that neither man could pay him back, so he canceled their debts. Which one do you think loved him more?" "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt," said Simon. "You're right," said Jesus. "When I came into your house, you didn't wash my feet. You didn't pour oil on my head. You didn't even give me a kiss of peace. But this woman did all that and more. She has been forgiven for a lot, and she loves me a lot." Jesus showed respect for Mary, the least acceptable person at the party. He even praised her efforts above Simon's. The last person anyone would have expected became a good example. That kind of respect took Mary by surprise. She was used to being unloved and left out. Now she was being appreciated. We all know people like Mary, people who get ignored or picked on. Jesus treated Mary kindly. He wanted her to feel wanted and respected. He wants to include every person in his family, just as he did Mary. And he wants us to treat one another the same way he treats us. This podcast is read by Fanita Buddy.
Scripture reading comes from Book of Luke, chapter 7, verses 36 to 43. "And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment and stood at his feet behind him, weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisees which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself, saying, This man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that touches him, for she is a sinner. And Jesus answering said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he saith, Master, say on. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed 500 pence and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him most? Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most, and he said unto them, thou hast rightly judged. Here ends the reading of God's holy word.
Tears that made her blind. She felt such pain, some spoke in anger, heard folks whispers, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before me. And though she spoke no word, everything she said was heard. As she poured her love for the Master from a box of alabaster. Thank you.
Amen. 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 The twins said to me this morning that they would like to do, behold, he stand at the door and knock, knock, knock. I said, are you still willing to do it? And Gabriella said, yes, Dad. Isabella said, she's not sure. Anyone hears my voice, if anyone hears my voice, and will come in, come in. Amen, amen. At least they were brave enough to stand up here. Amen, amen. Well done, well done. Take time. At least they went up and they tried. Amen. So amen for... Amen for trying. So thank you very much to the Lewis family for that lovely rendition. It's in harmony with the sermon that will be presented, and in harmony with the scripture reading and the children's story. As well, everything is in line by the grace of God. It's time for us to hear another word from the Lord. And it's a bit tricky when you stand here to preach and you stand in front of other preachers, especially preachers who stood up here last week and preached. Amen, amen, amen. Praise the Lord. But God is good, so time is against us. I'll just pray and get straight into the word. Let us pray. Our loving eternal Father who art in heaven, forgive us, Lord, where we have sinned and come short of your glory. We thank you very much for all that you have done for us, Lord. I pray that you will speak to our hearts now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So the title of the sermon today is Anointed by an Outlaw. What's the title of the sermon? By an outlaw. And I will not ask for a show of hands if you have been anointed by an outlaw. But all we know throughout the scriptures, throughout the Bible, when people are going to be anointed, they would normally be anointed by a prophet. So a prophet would normally anoint the person. A priest can anoint a person as well. But generally, it would not be an outlaw. An outlaw person would not even seek to come forward with the oil. So we are looking at anointed by an outlaw. How can an outlaw, if you're an outlaw, how can you anoint someone? Remember the anointing of David. When David was to be anointed as king of Israel, and David was there as a pastor or a shepherd, one and the same. He was a pastor in his pastures, and he was looking after his sheep, his church, his flock. And while he was out there looking after his flock, all his other brothers were at home, and they went before Samuel. And when Samuel looked and he saw the one that is tall and handsome, like Brother Colin, I was listening for the amen for Brother Colin, but we'll get it from on our way home. Or our Brother Ephraim, so he's looking for the tall, handsome one like Brother Ephraim and Brother Colin. But when he saw the tall, handsome one coming forward, and he believed that the oil would start to roll, so the anointing would take place, then the oil wasn't coming at all, because that wasn't God's one to be anointed. And the second one came, and so they all came. And when they came in front of the prophet, he realized that he hasn't gotten a word from the Lord. And because of that, he said, have you got another son somewhere? Not these tall, handsome ones, but have you got another one? A one that is ruddy in complexion, a one that is good looking as well, but younger. Have you got that one available? And they said, well, we have one, but he's in the pasture as a pastor, as a shepherd in the field. maybe he is not that one. I'm not sure if you ever been the black or the white sheep in your family. I'm not sure if you have always been the odd one out in your family. But that's how David was. He was the odd one out in his family. But even though he was the odd one out in his family, he was not the odd one out for God. So God said of David, this is the one. And Samuel was quick to anoint him. But he, Samuel, was not an outlaw. So let's look at our narrative today, anointed by an outlaw. Turn with me, if you will, to the scripture reading that was so ably read by our Elder Christine. Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7. Let's just look from verse 36 and see where we go by the grace of God. So verse 36 says, And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. So this man is seeking audience. He's giving Christ an invitation that Christ would eat with him. And he went unto the Pharisee's house and he sat down to eat. So it doesn't matter who you were, if you were rich or you were poor, Jesus would come to your house and he would sit down and he would eat with you. So one of the Pharisees, we had the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the Sanhedrin council, that big council of 70 men. He would be on that council, or you would say today on the board, on the church board. So he was a member of the board. He would be a very educated person. He would be one that is married, so he would be married generally with children, but at least he would be a married person. Hence, people say the Apostle Paul, because he was a member of that council, he was married at some point in his life. We're not sure exactly what happened. But this man would be an educated person, very educated person, and a scholar in the community. He would be one that people would look up to as a didaskalos, that's a teacher. So he would be a teacher. So as a teacher, a Pharisee, people would look up to him. He would be one who returns faithful tithes and offering. If he's going to return his offering, he would make sure that if he has a mint, he would count every single leaf. And when he gets to 10, this one belongs to God, and he would count again. So he wouldn't even take the chance to just give a whole figure. No, he would be specific in his giving and make sure that he gives the right thing. He would fast twice a week. And he would pray in the open when he's out there praying. And if anyone is coming along, he would pray even louder and longer for them to see his holiness. So they would see this holy Pharisee, and they would see him in his regalia, in his nice dress, his robe, his nice output, and they would see that this is indeed a religious person. If a Pharisee was walking down the road and they should see a beautiful woman like Sister Andel, amen. I see a beautiful woman like Sister Andel walking down the road coming towards him, then he would hide his face and he would run away. That's the Pharisee. Sometimes their head would be very bloody because they would bump into things running away from ladies when they see ladies on the street. And you're going to see that that's going to tie in with the sermon, because this lady should not even be around the table. Moreover, she is in the crowd and her hair should be tucked away and hidden away as it were. But she lets her hair down and she was washing and wiping the feet of Jesus Christ. So the Pharisee, remember, he would run from the ladies whenever he see them on the streets. The only one he should see let down their hair like that should be his wife. So imagine now, this is a Pharisee, a leader in Israel, someone who is wealthy like some of you out there. Amen. I know some of you don't want to say the amen lest we believe, okay, you are one of the wealthy ones, but my father is rich in houses and land. So this is a Pharisee now. The Pharisee, so it's his house that Christ is going to. And you might think of your posh house that you have today, and you might believe these solid walls that we have today. That's the type of house that he's going to. But no, the house of the Pharisee was not like that. It was something that would generally, like in Pharaoh's time, the bricks would be made from mud and different things, and they daub it around and they try to put straw in it to strengthen it. So that was the type of house that he had. And generally, on the outdoor, like you see the nice children's story, where they're in a nice enclosed building, generally back then, the house would be an open area like this. Not the house, the dining room or the dining area would be an open area in the yard. Those of you who know back home and they have veranda, something similar to that, the landing of your loft or of your what it's called. But anyway, so that's what it would be. But it's an open area. Generally, they have covering over. And their table that they sit around wouldn't be your nice table that you can seat 6 people or 8 people or 10 people or whatever amount of people. No, it would be, and it wouldn't be that they have chairs like these chairs that we have where they sit upright nicely and have their dinners. No, it would be couches that they have, and they would sit and they would rock over to the left. So they would be leaning on their left hand, and the table was very low, so they were almost sitting on the floor, really, or on the ground, and they were leaning over with their left hand, and they would leave their right hand free to eat the meal. So their feet wouldn't be underneath the table, but their feet would be behind them, and they are leaning over toward the table. So that's the setting back then. So that's very important to our narrative, lest you believe the lady bent underneath the table and went to wash the feet of Jesus. No, that wasn't the case at all. So that was the setting. So when a Pharisee is going to have a meeting or a meal, other people in the community would hear about it. People are just going down to Peckham Market, and they realize, wow, 2 rabbis are here, because Simon is a rabbi and Jesus is also a rabbi. So 2 teachers are here, so you can glean wisdom from these 2 rabbis. Remember, it was about maybe 5 or so percent or even less of the population that were able to read. So now you have 2 people who are able to read. Hence, they accused Jesus, or they asked Jesus, how can you read when you haven't gone to our rabbinical school? How can you read? Where did you get that ability from? So generally, people would just listen to someone read the Bible for them. And like today, where we have maybe over 60, 70, 80, 90 sometimes percent of the population are able to read. So when they are passing, they wouldn't really take part in the meal generally, so they would not go around the table. And remember, the Pharisee is not going to have any sinner around their table anyway. So if you are invited, you know you are not a sinner, because they would not associate themselves with sinners. Once they know you're a sinner, you're out. So while they are passing and they hear the rabbis questioning each other, throwing questions, and Simon would be questioning Christ and Christ throwing back questions at Simon, they would just stop at the fence, or they could come in the yard. They wouldn't be eating or anything, but they would be just there listening and taking in the whole story, the whole narrative, and getting a bit of wisdom from these 2 rabbis. So that was the setting, that was the background of our story. And it says, one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. So now you know where he's eating. And I should hasten on to tell you that normally, I've got a communion sermon like that. Normally, when they're around the table, who would be on the right and who would be on the left? Someone was saying it. Shout it out. And Judas. So Judas and John normally would be the closest to Jesus Christ when they are around the table in regular times. So John would be where? On the right, and Judas would be where? So Jesus would be crouching over like this. It's not like when they were leaving Egypt. We did a sermon about Egypt the other day. When they were leaving Egypt, they had to gird their loins because they were preparing to move. They were preparing for action. But no, they are not preparing for that because they are comfortable. They are in their land, their own land. Yes, they are controlled by the Romans, but they had quite a good freedom. So they had freedom. So Jesus would be like this normally and leaning down. And on the left side would be who? Judas. All right, let's use it as Judas. So Judas is on the left side. Hence, when Jesus is laying down like this, where is Jesus' head? Laying on the breast of Judas. You'll get that on your way home. And John's head, remember, they said John is the disciple that lay his head on the breast of Jesus. So John is over this side, and he's leaning over with his left arm, and his breast is on Jesus's, his head is on Jesus's breast, while Jesus is leaning his head on the breast of Judas, the one who is going to betray him. That's another sermon. But now, as the head of the house, two persons are now close to Jesus Christ. Who are those two persons? It's not John, it's not Judas. Quick guess. Peter, good guess, but Peter is always up front, so good, very, very good guess. But it's Simon and who? Lazarus. So it's Lazarus and Simon. Remember, Lazarus just came back from the dead, and they were in his local area, his hometown. So where you think Lazarus would be and where you think Simon would be? If it's his home, he would be where? On the right. And that's an assumption. We know they were both beside them by spirit of prophecy, but spirit of prophecy didn't say directly who. But I can just assume, as a Pharisee, and normally if someone comes to your house, when you give them that chair, you would take the next highest chair. And knowing a Pharisee, he would take the highest chair. So I can see Jesus leaning over and eating and resting here, and who? Lazarus, that had died, and then over his right, resting on his bosom, is Simon. So Simon the leper is there. So one, Jesus saved, hallelujah, from a sure death, because leprosy was a death sentence back there. So one, Christ raised him by the power of God. Since the time of Elijah, you never had anyone who could speak to leprosy and leprosy disappear like that. Away from Elijah and Elisha and Naaman, away from that, throughout the time, no leper was healed. But now Jesus saw Simon, hallelujah, as a leper, and Jesus spoke to Simon as a leper, and Jesus said, be healed. And by the power, hallelujah, invested in him, Simon was healed. And now Simon wants to repay Jesus for his goodness. So Simon invited Jesus for the feast, and everyone came there also, not to see Jesus mainly, not to see Simon merely, who were healed, or the one who healed them, but also to see Lazarus, who came back from the dead after 4 days. And Martha's testimony is, by now he what? You can smell him. You can smell him. So Jesus, maybe you just want to view my brother's body, but it's not a good time to view a person after they've been buried for 4 days. I won't go too much into that. It's not lunchtime as yet. But it's not a good time to view his body, because Jesus, it's his decomposing body that you will find there. And Jesus says, remove the stone. And the word that Jesus used to remove the stone is to remove the stone once and for all. I'm not going to ask you to remove the stone, then put it back. Once you remove the stone, I will bring him to life. There is no need to put the stone back. And too many of us been removing the stone and putting the stone back in front of our own graves, when Jesus already called you by name and say to you, come forth. Hallelujah. And they came there to see Lazarus, because by then, there's so much in the sermon, and I'm rushing through, but I'm so much, we haven't even started as yet. This bit is for free that I'm giving you. So Jesus now is right there. But people came to see Lazarus, because imagine if you were in the house, that in the yard that day, and when Jesus asked to remove the stone, and when you hear that rumbling within the tomb, some of you who are afraid of a certain thing would start running. Be honest. Speak the truth and shame the devil. Once you know that that person has been dead for 4 days, and you realize someone said, move the stone, and you hear rumbling coming out of that grave, they would have to catch you going. if you were a certain place in the world, they would say you take your foot in your hand, not literally like this, but it means you are going faster than Hussein Bolt. So imagine if you were there at that time. So people now are present at the feast because they want to hear Lazarus. What did you see? Did you go to heaven? Did you meet Jesus? Did you meet Moses? Did you meet Aaron? And imagine if you were there, the questions that you would ask Lazarus, was it really asleep where you didn't know anything? What happened there? Some of the scholars said Lazarus did not even smile again after he came back from the dead. I don't know if that's true, but that's the scholarship. But Lazarus did not have a word to say to them because the Bible says the dead knows not anything, but the living know that they shall die. So even though he was there, he couldn't say anything to them because he did not know anything. Death is like a sleep. You don't know anything, even more than the regular sleep it is. Anyway, so now that's the Pharisee's house. That's the setting. That's everything. And they went to the Pharisee's house. So they are at the Pharisee's house now. And they sat down. They crouched over. You know how the position they were in for meal. And the table is spread. And there is talking on the floor. And some people are quiet because you believe your wisdom can't match with these two rabbis. And the two rabbis are on the floor. I can just imagine Jesus giving them gems and wisdom. But Simon also wants to prove a point. Simon also wants to prove that he is a rabbi. He is a master. He is a ruler. He is a teacher. And it says, behold, verse 37, a woman. You know someone, I'm not sure who did this song. You probably would know it. The song says, this is a man's world. Who does that song? You haven't got a clue. If we weren't in church, maybe you'd have told me, but everyone might start looking at you. How do you know that song? But anyway, so back then it was a man's world, so it was true to form. It was a man's world back then. Thank God that ladies have got equal rights and responsibilities today. One lady realized that. The rest will get it on our way home. But I'm happy for that. Remember, I'm surrounded by ladies at home anyway. I'm outnumbered. Amen. So what can I say? I have to speak well of the ladies. Not even an amen from my own household. I'll get the amen from my wife on my way home. I'll get the amen on my way home. Amen. So on a serious note now, so it was a man's world. That's why Jesus had 12 disciples, and they were all 12 men, as it were. So no lady was on his team. So I'm giving you the historical facts. So please don't leave here and say that the preacher said this world is a man's world. No, I didn't say that at all. I'm giving you the historical facts. That's what we are looking at. And then hopefully to apply this sermon to us in 2021. So a woman. So the contrast between the man and the woman was great already, just in itself. Just by being a man, you would have a lot more opportunity than being a woman back then. Now ladies can be presidents and prime ministers. Amen. But just being a woman, you would be below the man already. So now look, it's not just a normal man, like a man who does day's work or day's labor. No, it's a Pharisee. So he's on top of his game, as it were. He's a top man in the society. And now this poor, feeble, frail lady. And the Bible says, and behold, a woman in the city. So the woman was in the city or from the same city, which was a... You're not reading with me. We're at verse 37. A sinner, verse 37 of Luke chapter 7. She was a sinner. So she was not only a woman, but she was a sinner. And Simon was not only a man, but he was a what? A very holy man, a Pharisee. So one is a man, very holy man, and one is an outlaw or a sinner, follow the narrative. So she is a sinner, and Luke is making it clear that how she would be identified back there, she would be identified as a what? A sinner. And when they use the word a sinner, for this particular woman, there's a connotation behind it, that she was a woman of the night or of the streets. Again, you'll get that on your way home. So she was a woman of the night. She was a part of the oldest trade ever. You'll get that on your way home again. So she was from this particular profession. So she was a sinner. So Simon didn't want to have her around. And when she knew, she had a keen knowledge, she knew. It wasn't that she assumed that Jesus was there. When she knew that Jesus sat at meal and was now comfortable having his meal at the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment. And in other versions, it tells you of spikenard. Alabaster box of ointment of spikenard. This box, because of where it was origin from in Egypt, it got that name. This box or this perfume, have you ever been to the perfume shop? Don't raise your hands. But it's like you are going to, let me not give any advertisement to them, but any shop that sells good perfume. So imagine you're going to go to that shop. So the ladies would normally wear it around their necks as a dowry. So it would be a gift, sometimes their wedding gift, as it were. So very expensive spikenard, as it were, or alabaster box. So very, very expensive. In our day, the value of this would be, in the UK, would be between 20 to 30,000. It would be a year's wages. So it wouldn't be Simon's wages. He would be getting that. It wouldn't be Mr. Johnson's wages. He's getting more than that. But it would be the average wage, as it were, between $20,000 and $30,000. So a year's wages. Where would this woman get this money from? Well, we know she was in a very lucrative type of trade. But wherever she got the money from, she purchased this money, perfume, and she decided to invest not in herself, but in the Lord. So she had this, one assumed based on the culture of the day, around her neck, and she creeps in quietly. Did not go under any table. There was no table for her to go under. And she came behind Jesus. Let's read on the narrative. When she knew, verse 38, and she stood at his feet before him weeping. Thank you. So you are not sleeping on me. Amen. Our praise team is still awake. That's good. Not that they normally sleep. So she came in behind him. And we gave you the whole layout already. That's why she was behind him, because his feet would be behind him. So it's saying she came behind him weeping. She was overwhelmed. Hallelujah. I'm not sure if you have ever been overwhelmed by the love of God. I'm not sure if God has ever done anything for you where you know your mother, your father, your sister, your brother would not have forgiven you, but Jesus has forgiven you and has given you a new life, and you are overwhelmed with the goodness of Jesus. Hallelujah. As C.C. Winans says, that the goodness of God is running after me. It's running after me. And as David says, hallelujah, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me, not some, but all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So she was overwhelmed with the grace of God. Not even her brother or her sister would have forgiven her. The Pharisees would not have forgiven her. But Jesus, hallelujah, has forgiven her. And she's now in the presence of omnipotence. She's not in the presence of an ordinary man. Simon didn't know that because of what he's going to say later. But Jesus, but Mary, or this woman, Mary, as she is Mary, this was Mary, the sister of Jesus, the sister of Lazarus, who was dead. So Mary knew that she was in the presence of Jesus. She knew that she was at the same place, hallelujah, where Jacob slept the night and used the stone as his pillow and got up in the morning. And when he looked around, he said, wow, I was in the presence of God, and I did not even know it. I'm not sure if you have ever felt the presence of God, the rich presence of God, and you realize that you are not consumed, so you realize the love of God towards you. So it is when Mary realized that it's the same presence of God that Isaiah was in, when Isaiah said, woe is me, for I am undone, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. Isaiah fell down as a dead person in the same presence of Jesus Christ. It's the same personage that Moses, when he says, Lord, show me yourself. And God says, Moses, I can't even give you your request. You're asking to see me, but I will not show you my glory. I will show you my goodness. And God passed over Moses and hid Moses, hallelujah, in the rock and removed his hand. And all Moses saw was the back part of God. And Moses was like a dead man, as it were, when he went down. His face was glowing. It's the same presence of God that this woman was in. And she was now weeping and crying to know that she's in the presence of omnipotence. Hallelujah. What a God who would forgive me. If you know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box, you don't know the cost of my praise. Sometimes you see a person come to church, and you might look back on them two or three times after they say amen and hallelujah and praise the Lord. But you don't know the cost of their praise. You might see them as an outlaw, but even Jesus can be anointed by an outlaw. It's a sincere heart that Jesus wants. Sometimes you see a person come to church and they are just crying. They are just crying. They are in the presence of God. You know how, based on my profession, being a minister, at times I speak to people who really want to be where you are now. They just want the chance to come back to church again. They just want God, hallelujah, to bring them back from their deathbed, as it were, and to heal them and to restore them to be where some of us take for granted, to be in church again. It was David who says, I was glad when they said, hallelujah, unto me, come, let us go in the house of the Lord. And the rejoicing started not when he got in the house of the Lord, but when he got the invitation to go in the house of the Lord, because he knows that in God's house there is fullness of joy and peace forevermore. So just the very invitation to go in the house of the Lord, he has to say to others, come taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed, hallelujah, is the one who puts their trust in him. So this lady was in the presence of omnipotence, was in the presence of God. And she's tearing open, she's crying, uncontrollable. As it were, you know, some people in certain community can bawl. Amen. They don't even cry, they bawl. So this lady is there crying. Time is defeating us. I'll have part two. I'm not going to keep you too late. I'll have part two. I'll pick up another time, God willing. God willing. And she began to wash his feet with her tears. So the tears were just flowing. She began to wash Jesus' feet, and she let her hair loose. She looked around and there was no napkin in her hand. She looked around and she never had a nice flannel like me. Amen. So she You know, sometimes people in the church complain too much. We just have to be honest. Sometimes we complain and we moan against God too much. We have so much to be thankful for. This lady could start to complain, could look at someone and say, you know what? I didn't remember to bring my flannel to church, or I didn't remember to bring my towel with me. How could I? She said, but what have I got? And that's what God is saying to you. What have you got in your hands? Use what you have in your hands. And all she had was her hair, which she shouldn't take out in the public anyway. But she's not doing it for man. You know, some of you who are here today, if it was for us as church members, you wouldn't be here. I just have to be honest. It's the love of God why you are here. It's the love of God why you drag yourself out of your bed this morning just to be here in the presence of God. It's the love of God. And this woman started to wipe the feet of Jesus with her hair, as it were, the hair of her head, and kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. When she broke that ointment, the entire place was filled with the aroma, with the fragrance. Imagine, I will not ask for a show of hands. I don't think you are in here, so I won't ask for a show of hands. For those of you who would take £20,000 and purchase a perfume. But this lady, she values Christ so much. She took £20,000, a year's wage. And Judas muttered. Sometimes you bring your praise to church and someone is going to say something. Why? What is she doing? What is he doing? Do they believe they are more holy than other people? You're not doing it for other people. And Judah said, what a waste. This perfume could be sold for over 300 denarii. I could be sold for 300 pence. And we could give the money to the poor. So he did not value Jesus as much. And Judas was a thief. The Bible says it, not me. So he wanted the money to put in the bag. And look what Judas did just days after. This was 6 days before the crucifixion of Christ. It was the end, the final week of Christ on earth. And before that week would finish, Judas would go and would sell his Lord. Not for 300 pieces of denarii, but for 30 pieces of silver. That's how much he valued his Lord. And when this lady was pouring, you know, when we have our folks who are alive and well, you have your mother and your father and your sister and your brother and folks in the church, love them now. Give them the flowers now. Broke your alabaster box now. Let them smell the fragrance while they're alive. If Mary had gone to the grave of Jesus Christ, Jesus would not smell the ointment, the fragrance from that ointment. Sometimes we give our folks flowers when they are dead, and when they're alive, we do not give them anything. I've committed a lady already, and the lady, I buried her, and the lady, more or less, died for hunger or for want. And at her funeral, there was so much food. You could eat and take home and eat and take again and take again. And while she was alive, they did not give her anything or very little. When you have your loved one alive, treat each other good now. Treat people right in the church now. You see people today, tomorrow they might be gone, and they are gone forever. You can't give them the flowers anymore.
Put all the flowers you want. They can't smell it. Give them the roses while they're alive. Let us love each other by the grace of God. For God says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. Take care of your loved ones now. And Mary was willing to give Christ 20,000 pounds. Was it a waste? That's what Judas said, but it wasn't. He wasn't wasting his time. She wasn't wasting her time nor her money. So it is, people say, it's a waste for Christ to come from the splendor of heaven and to give himself for us. Say, so why couldn't an angel do it? Why couldn't Christ give just some of what he's going to offer? Why, the songwriter says, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Why Jesus have to give all? And people see it as a waste, but it's not a waste. Jesus gave all, and heaven gave enough to save every human being on this planet and to leave more grace out for anyone whosoever will come unto me. I will in no wise cast out. There is enough grace. The blood of Jesus Christ was shed for you. It doesn't matter where you are or what you have done. God says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. And it's not 20,000 pounds that Jesus paid for you, but Jesus gave his own life. And the Bible says, for a friend or for a good person, some will die. But the Bible declares, hallelujah, that while we were yet sinning, Christ died for us and paid such a lavish price, as it were. His grace was running after us. And Simon has the audacity to say, if Jesus knew this woman who was touching her, that she's not one of my servants, but she's a sinner woman. If Jesus knew, and while he's saying that, I'll unwrap that in part two. While he's saying that, Jesus is reading his mind. Imagine what's going on through your mind now. Imagine if I say it on the microphone, that this is what you're thinking now as I'm preaching. And Jesus revealed to Simon exactly the hidden secrets of his heart to show that, Simon, I'm not only a prophet, I am the Son of God. I am God incarnate. I am the I am that I am. Imagine that. And Simon realized that Jesus could reveal everything, because you know what? Simon was the one who led this woman into sin. Simon was the one who led this woman down that road. So yes, she became a sinner by his act. She was abused by him. He started her off like that, and she continued down that road. And now he has the audacity to look down his sanctified nose at her and calling her a sinner, and realize that Christ could open up all his secrets to him on that day, and just to shoot him down, as it were. But Jesus was saving Mary, hallelujah, and saving Simon at the same time. When Simon saw the love of God, that Christ could just expose him, because Christ is reading his heart, and Christ did not expose him. He became a true follower of Jesus Christ. And that was the story of Mary. But this Mary was the same woman that Christ looked her eyeball to eyeball 7 times, not 5. But 7 times Christ looked her eyeball to eyeball, and they jogged her before Christ again. Here is this woman, Christ. And Christ healed her, and Christ drove the demons out from her, as it were. And they brought her again, and she found herself in the presence of God again. And the 7th time she believed that if God would forgive me 6 times, he certainly will not forgive me a 2nd time. And her own conscience condemned her. But the Bible says there's one that is greater than your conscience. That's Jesus Christ himself. And even though he was condemned, she was condemned, Jesus looked at her and he forgave her again and healed her. And that's why Jesus could ask Simon that question, who you think out of the two will love him more? the one that received the forgiveness. But the Bible says Jesus turned to Mary but spoke to Simon. That's for part two. He turns to Mary, but he's speaking to Simon. We'll come back, God willing, and do part two. But I must stop here. I'm not sure if the family is able to come back and do alabaster box for me as we close off. Very, very appropriate song. So C.C. Winer says, the room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbles through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger. There's nowhere for her kind.
The tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger. Heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face. She knelt before him, and though she spoke no word, everything she said was heard as she poured her love for the master from the box of alabaster. I'm too poor, my grace. Like don't be angry if I
Praise the Lord. Thank you very much. I don't know who you are, but I know you are out there somewhere. You might be online. You might be in the church. But you'd like to say, preacher, pray for me. Preacher, you don't know the cost of my praise. You don't know why I would spend £20,000 or more on Jesus Christ. And seems as if I'm wasting it, but Jesus said, no, she's preparing me for the burial. Within a week's time, I will be buried. And she's preparing. She came ahead of time. And wherever this gospel is preached around the world, this will be mentioned of her. I don't know where you are. If you are in church, could you raise your hands, please? You would like a special prayer. I don't know what you are going through. Amen. I can see those hands going up. I can see those hands going up. We've been sitting for a long time. Just stand with me, please, if you would like a special prayer. And those of you who are online, if you would like special prayer or if you would like to be baptized in our next baptism, you'd like us to prepare you, to study with you, put it in the chat. We'll find a way of communicating with you. Don't put your number in the chat. Just put that you would like to get baptized or you'd like someone to do Bible studies with you. I don't know what you are going through. All of us have got our own alabaster box. We all have our own challenges that we are going through. But Jesus says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So I'm going to pray for you now and pray for myself in a very special way that God will have his own way in our own lives. And just remember, go and sin no more. Jesus does not condemn you. Yes, he knows all that you have done. But even with that, he loves you. Jesus doesn't love you because of who you are, or because of who we are. He loves us in spite of who we are. The servant of God says in the book Desire of Ages, page 57, it proves that while the hatred of God for sin is as strong as death, the love of God for the sinner is stronger than death. Let's pray. Our loving eternal Father who art in heaven, Lord, only me know the cost of the oil in my own alabaster box. Lord, only each person here or online, Lord, know the cost of their own praise. Only we know what you have done for us, Lord. And I thank you for the power of your Holy Spirit. But if the truth be told, like Mary, Lord, you have forgiven us the first time, but we find ourselves sinning again a second and a third time and over again. And each time we find ourselves in front of you, like today, Lord, we are asking you for forgiveness of our sins, and you are saying to us, go in peace, hallelujah. And that's the same peace that Jesus said to this lady, go in peace, is the same peace Jesus said, my peace I leave with you. My peace give I unto you. It's a peace that passes all understanding. It's a peace that the world cannot give you. It's a peace that the world cannot take away from you. Lord, those who would like to get baptized and they are struggling at this moment, I pray for the victory in Jesus Christ, Lord. It was the same Mary that you drove out demons out of seven times, Lord. You drove out demons out of her. But thank God she was the first evangelist at your funeral service, your resurrection, Lord. She was the first person to publish the good news of salvation, that Jesus is alive. He's risen. Go and tell Peter and the others that Jesus is alive. It's that same Mary, that same member of the church that people have written off, that people believe that you should not have done that, you should have known better. But Jesus says, go in peace today. Lord, some of us have been carrying burdens for many years, Lord. But help us to know today that burdens are still lifted at Calvary because Jesus is very near. Thank you for the freedom that you have given us, for the word declares that the one that the Son has set free is free indeed. Thank you, Lord, for that freedom. So we can leave church today free in you, Lord. Sing with the Negro spiritual, free at last. Thank God, hallelujah, we are free at last. Help us to go forth now in the liberty with which the Lord has made us free. Thank you, Lord, for hearing and for answering our prayers. Be with the bereaved, be with the sick, be with all of us. In Jesus' blessed name we pray. Amen and amen. 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 Thank you very much for worshiping with us today. I'm not sure if we are going to do the closing hymn. Are we going to do the closing hymn, Sister Beth? Are you up to the closing? Okay, all right. The singers, so we'll just say goodbye to you. We'll do our slideshow. But thank you very much for those of you who are online, who have watched us online. See you next week by the grace of God. And those of you at church, God bless you real good. And take care of yourself. May God bless and keep you. And remember to pray for myself and my family as well. In a very special way. God bless you.
Church, say, let the church say, amen. 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 Jesus.